But also, one of the things I want to say is that this is a fascinating, it's not my idea, it's a historian, but it's fascinating to me, is one of the reasons people say, why is this such a big deal in the United States and not in other countries? Well, first of all, now it is. And when I first spoke about this in Europe, they said, this is Americans. But it's getting there, because the United States exports everything, good and bad, and it's happening in England, in Holland, in France, in all sorts of countries. But one of the things that's been really remarkable that was pointed out is that one of the reasons that religion is so successful here, it would be better if we didn't have a separation of church and state, if we had a state religion. Because if you have a state religion, everyone ignores it, like in England. And it becomes impotent, because capitalism just works. And so if you have, we forced religions in this country to become entrepreneurial. And they've been incredibly successful because of it. So if we just had a state religion, then it'd be fine. Then no one would want to talk about it anymore.
I think there's a lot in that. I mean, you've no idea how boring the Church of England is in India.
This question is inspired by recently watching Jesus Camp, which is all about indoctrination.
Terrifying movie to watch. Yeah.
Child abuse.
Yeah.
Also something that you discussed about how we reach children. And so I don't want to, maybe this is a bad line of reasoning, but I want to ask, what about popularizing the teaching of evolution even farther than it is, like, say, Darwin Camp or virus versus people? Is there a line where you try and reach people at their heart on their kids in the same way that the opposition is? I mean, Timonen can sell 60 million copies of the Rapture and the Times book. Should there be Darwinian novelists with Charles as your protagonist?
Well, I think, absolutely. In fact, I was a judge at the Sundance Film Festival specifically because the Sloan Foundation gives a prize for trying to introduce, not to have a science documentary, but trying to introduce scientific themes in full-length feature films or scientists, you know, to humanize them. And I absolutely think that we really have to do a much better job, and I try personally whenever I can, to bridge what is a gap between science and culture. That science is not viewed as a part of our culture, and it should be viewed as that. And I really think we should be working to have science a much more integrated part of all of our culture and celebrate it in schools and, in fact, in churches and in literature. But I would hope scientists would, on the other hand, never stoop to the child abuse that is in Jesus Camp. I mean, what we should be encouraging kids to do is to have fun, to keep their minds open, to want to explore, to want to ask questions, and then the rest will follow. I don't think we should ever say, "And if you don't believe in Darwin, you're going to go to hell." I mean, that's you know.
Well, you laugh, but I mean, that's what they do, and so I mean, it just brings up the comparison. I have an ambition. At some point in my life to write a children's book about evolution. And I really don't, it comes back to the thing we were first discussing, it shouldn't be that difficult to explain. I don't understand, I think we talked about this as well, I don't understand why evolution is left to the end of scientific education.
Yeah.
It should be at the beginning, because then everything makes sense. And I don't know about camp, why not camps? I mean, I don't come from a culture where children do get sent off to camp, but it sounds rather a nice thing to do. I would love to try to teach evolution at a children's.
When I was a kid, there were, I mean, I essentially went to things called, like, they were essentially like science camps. So they weren't like Jesus Camp, but they were places where you could, you know, do science and have fun and explore and do visits to places, and that's a good thing. But I think I wanted to ask, actually, in that regard, I wanted to ask you. It's interesting that evolution is taught at the end of biology class, because there was, I forget which famous biologist said, nothing in biology makes sense without
evolution.
Well,
it was Dobzhansky,
yeah.
but any biologist would say that.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I wanted to ask if one of the things that's really scary to me in this country, and my daughter went to a rather liberal school, private school, but her teacher, and this is where they've been really successful, even if they haven't distorted the curriculum, they've instilled enough fear in teachers that there are many teachers in this country, biology teachers, who won't mention the word evolution, not because it's not there, but they're just afraid. And even in my daughter's school, I remember her biology teacher basically apologized each time he mentioned the word evolution. I was just shocked. But it happens.
Well, all right, I mean, that's a major evil. What are we going to do about it? It's terrible. That's absolutely terrible. Teachers are being intimidated. I mean, are there any teachers here who can testify to that by any chance?
Yeah. Yes, there's one in front. I can't
see. Are you being intimidated by children, by parents, by other teachers, by what? Parents.
Well, you know, but it's even more intimidating. You know what happened in Texas? So the school board official recommended there was an event on evolution, a bunch of interesting speakers, and the school official and the school board sent out the notice that this event was happening, and she got fired. Because she didn't present the other, she didn't talk about the other side. Can you believe that? But that's the kind of intimidation that actually happens, and it's really scary.
Well, I don't know if there's anything I can do to help, but I kind of feel the need to to do something.
As Steve Weinberg says, we're doing God's work. But anyway.
I think one of the problems that scientists have in evangelical science is the fact that the field of science is so large and complex. And you can spend a lifetime studying even a small area and not understand all of it. And I think one of the things that we have to do to sell science is to present it in a coherent, compact way and to tell stories about science that are accessible to people. And you've both written lots of books, some of which I've read, and both fantastic writers. I think, though, that books have a limited audience. And I think the medium that will reach a lot more people is actually film. And so I think of another great evangelist for science, Al Gore, who had written books and given lots of speeches, but I think really came into prominence and raised the consciousness of our nation about climate change with his movie. So my question is, and Professor Dawkins, I watched your Virus of Faith film aired by the BBC, which I thought was very good.
Which film?
It's called Virus of Faith.
It may have had a different name here in the U.S.
Channel 4 in England.
You don't remember doing that?
It's a 2-hour-long film.
The phrase is mine, but I don't remember making a film about it.
That was very good. You should look it up. Yeah. There's a link on the website. My question is, would either of you, in collaboration with other scientists, consider making a science creation film that tells the story of science from the Big Bang to now, talking about cosmology, galaxies, the history of life on Earth, the history of hominids, and putting it into something that's presentable to people and can be watched in a movie theater on Saturday night.
I agree, it'd be great. And I'd love to do it if there's anyone with $20 or $50 million here who'd like to contribute. I think both of us do TV. Richard does more film than me up in England, I think. And you're absolutely right that books reach a limited audience. And I don't think film, I actually think television reaches the broadest audience. And it really saddens me. And I've had it happen. I talk to TV producers a lot. I'm on a lot of TV programs different ways. But I really would love to get on a mainstream, not the Science Channel, because that's a self-selecting group, or not the Discovery, or a lot of those places where I normally appear. But in a regular program, it's extremely difficult to convince them that and because it's all driven by ratings and money, and the perception of network executives is that science will not draw people in. And it is amazingly, it's a ridiculous perception, because if done right, it could be an incredible draw. But that's a very difficult thing to overcome. And I'm hoping that we can slowly try and overcome it. And I'm trying to do it, but it's a difficult job. I don't know whether you want